The Tribe, A New Dawn by AJ Penn, narrated by Beth Allen, Caleb Ross, Antonia Prebble, Matt Robinson, Meryl Cassie, Michelle Ang, and Damon Andrews, featuring Suzanne Robinson, Cameron Thompson, Fabricio Porcel, and Rannie James. Dedicated to the fans who keep the dream alive, and with loving thanks to my family, and for every day being a part of your tribe.
Prologue. Tai San took a moment to watch the sun ascend over the distant hills, casting its warm glow all around her, spreading beams of light across the darkness of the surrounding countryside, bringing the dawn of a new day. Grasping the wooden handle of the rusty scythe in her hands, her fingers sore and aching from the many splinters, blisters, and cuts she had suffered, Tai San braced herself for the heavy work ahead. It was harvest time, and she was to reap the crop she herself had planted what felt like an eternity ago. She had been awoken in the very early hours of the morning by her captors and taken to the field so she could begin her manual toil. It was the same routine she had gone through for how many months? She did not know. All feeling of time passing had long since gone, each day rolling into the next in an endless cycle of slave labor. It was a miracle the crop had grown as well as it had, Tai San felt, admiring the corn that now circled her. Proud that she had brought life to such a barren and inhospitable land, the field having been nothing more than an empty patch of earth when she first arrived. Thank you, Tai San whispered to the corn, her voice hoarse and throat dry from the endless billowing of dust. But it was also in gratitude to the spirits of the elemental world as she sliced the first gathering of the harvest and gave thanks to nature for what it had provided. The sounds of swishing and swirling of farm implements held by her fellow slave workers filled the air as work began in earnest, joining the morning chorus of birdsong. Tai San glanced at the birds fluttering overhead in the dawn sky. Would she ever be like them? Free to go where she wished, to do as she chose, like she had been once before? Or was her life to be forever one of captivity, a prisoner to others seeking to make her an instrument of their will? How she wished she could soar above like the birds and escape her plight. She had thought about escaping many times, but there were too many guards. Her captors were well organized and disciplined. No prisoner had ever successfully escaped. All who had tried had been punished severely, with the result that other slave workers were also collectively reprimanded, even if they were innocent, to discourage any further attempts. Tai San couldn't take the selfish path and try and secure her own freedom because she knew that by doing so, other prisoners would suffer as a consequence, especially if she succeeded in making an escape. There was to be no getting away. Not yet. Some of the other slave workers nearby were already exhausted, for all it was the start of a new day, and cried out, having received a kick from the guards to signify there would be no respite from their expected toil. But any weeping was probably more due to the fact that most had lost all hope, their spirits crushed, bodies aching, their tears watering the dusty soil. Tai San worked steadfastly, though. She refused to let her plight get the better of her. She still had her pride, dignity, her inner essence. She hadn't lost herself or her identity, and long ago resolved that her captors would not break her. Somehow, she would pull through. Nature was sustaining Tai San, enriching her life force, bringing her solace, perspective, and inner peace. The sun on her face, the birds singing, the plants and insect life all around her, The power, energy, and sounds of the natural world drowned out whatever inner anxieties Tyson had about her own fate, any fears of the future. She was part of a bigger picture, aware of her connection to the earth itself. Nothing could extinguish Tyson's own inner fire, quell her unbreakable spirit. Her captors had taken away Tyson's freedom and her time, but she would not allow them to take away or infiltrate her soul, her hopes, or her dreams of what still could be. The sun would rise again, Tyson knew, and in that new dawn, there would always be a future. There was something greater in life that no physical captivity could ever imprison. Her spirit was free. Suddenly, Tyson heard the sounds of an approaching vehicle and looked around to see a van moving at speed, churning up clouds of dust. It was the first vehicle Tyson had seen for a long time. She had lived in isolation with her fellow slaves under the watchful eyes of the overseers and usually didn't see any outsiders. As the van skidded to a halt, the door on the side opened and several guards jumped out to be met by the overseers. Tyson continued scything in the harvest, glancing out of the corner of her eye, wondering what it all signified. She heard an animated conversation taking place between the overseers and the new guards. They, like Tyson's fellow prisoners, were all about the same age. Tyson did not understand the language they spoke. She was far from home in a foreign land, but there was no need to. It was clear from the tone of the voices that there was something of importance going on. One of the overseers was now pointing at her, and the guards began walking towards Tyson, a sense of purpose in their stride. Tyson wondered why she alone, out of the other slaves, had aroused their interest. "What do you want?" Tyson asked, instinctively feeling threatened, her voice raspy, staring defiantly. It was pointless to ask, she reflected, since it was unlikely the guards also spoke her language. The guards encircled her, heavily outnumbered. She considered using the scythe in her hands as a weapon in self-defense. In a split second, the guards lunged, seizing Tyson by the arms, one of them squeezing her wrist, forcing her to drop the scythe on the ground. Tyson protested, struggling and squirming to get away as she was lifted up into the air. The guards grabbed her by her legs and carrying her. Tired, weak, and emaciated, there was nothing she could do to get out of their clutches. She was blindfolded, and a cloth was tied around her mouth, suppressing Tyson's desperate cries. None of the other slaves came to her aid, too intimidated by their captors to offer assistance, and they watched as Tyson was carried by the guards into the van, the door quickly closing heavily behind her. The vehicle took off at speed, accelerating away, leaving behind the billowing dust receding in the slave fields that had for so long been Tyson's home. Over the ensuing days, Tyson had been taken some distance to a different city, and then placed in a well-guarded house full of other prisoners, but had been kept apart from them in a solitary room, the door locked at all times. Her abductors had fed her amply and cleaned her up. Her long, mottled, filthy, tangled hair had been washed. The dust and dirt from her previous existence as an agricultural slave washed away. The food she was given was most welcome, as was the feeling of being clean. Well-treated as she had been, ultimately she was still a captive, however, and felt she had exchanged one form of slavery for another. Her hopes were raised that something else might be in store when a female jailer brought Tyson a fresh change of clothes, exchanging the rags she wore for a pretty dress. Her fingernails were manicured, a flower tastefully arranged in her hair. Tyson had even had some makeup put on her face, accentuating her natural physical beauty. The intentions of her captors became clearer when she was taken later in the day to a public gathering in a street, in a city Tyson did not recognize, along with the rest of the prisoners from the slave house. Tyson and the other slaves had been manacled together in chains and were paraded before an assembled crowd, the onlookers eyeing the slaves with interest, assessing them. So it was to be an auction, Tyson realized. She was to be put up for sale. One by one, the slaves were presented to the audience, the auctioneer leading the proceedings, surveying the crowd as hands shot up, arms were waved, bids called out. It was a cacophony of noise, a disorderly mess of baying.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.